Ladies and gentlemen, once again, I want to invite you to this very, very, very incisive talk show, The Cardinal Talk, that comes to you every Sundays at this particular moment on your TV station, Lolwe TV. Today, as usual, we have for you some very juicy topics to discuss here. However, it is a topic of serious analysis about democracy in Africa. Our democratic development has been slowing, rather, should I say that, because we've seen tendencies that actually are not democratic enough. But this, again, is not going to help us as a continent. But we want to know, why are we slipping off? Is it democracy that is so heavy for us to bear, or is it our own mentality that is actually causing all this? With me to discuss all this today is the very, very able panel of Anthony. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
Samson, welcome to the program. Mr. Kitonga, karibu sana.
Asante sana.
Now, gentlemen, let's begin by talking about the African democracy. Now, it's like 20 years down the line when the clarion call for democracy in Africa actually gained foot. But again, we are looking at a situation now that is looking, that looks like we are now again backtracking. Case in point, the Ugandan by-elections. Should I start with you, sir?
Thank you. Nick, I think despite us having made the progress in other areas, even with, in technology, we've pretty much caught up with the rest of the world. When it comes to citizens from Africa, we are equally capable, like say other scientists, doctors. But when it comes to democracy, I think we are still caught up in our own old cultural system. Because in our African culture, really, I don't think we didn't practice democracy as such. There wasn't that much democratic space. And it seems our leaders, they didn't want to hang on to that, because they are, as you said, democracy seems to be very, very heavy to internalize, going by what we've been seeing in most African countries. Uganda, by the way, Uganda definitely, what the elections we had there, it was a sham. You know, it is very, very disappointing that the person of Museveni, whom we needed to had so much hope, and most of Africa celebrated when he came to power in 1986. Most of Africa celebrated that a freedom hero has come to power, and we really expected a lot of difference. He has made some progress in some development in Uganda. It has made some progress, but still, it is too kidogo. We expected Uganda to have done much, much better than where Museveni has taken it.
In terms of democracy, so to speak.
Yes.
Yes, Samson, what is your take about this case in point, the African scenario, and if you can zero in about the elections that actually concluded just recently in Uganda? What's your take?
I think, number one, we start from actually representative democracy. The worst form of democracy in the world is the representative democracy, without of a lot of contradiction, and it's fake from the onset at the very level of its definition, that you are defining democracy as a rule of the people, by the people, and for the people. If you look at it carefully, you'll find actually, if the people are ruling, why are they crying for the resources? If democracy is their rule. So it goes back to actually, it's fake from the very level of definition. And I remember, if you look at the concept of Pan-Africanism, what they wanted, and you look at actually now the person who had the spirit when they destroyed just the other day and the system was Jamahiriya system in Libya. If you look actually around and you take the Jamahiriya as a scientific study, and you see actually what Gaddafi did in Libya, you'll find a system which actually people need actually to learn, so that to know what was positive. But what do you know about Libya in the first place? You only see the propaganda from the Western world. I want to tell you, in America, it's not a successful story as far as democracy is concerned. The other day, I think 2 days ago, I saw Professor Makau Mutua was in the country, was in the bench, and telling us that there's actually another candidate now, the campaign which is going in the US. Somebody who is actually is a racist, talking about racist. The guy is very popular. But professor was telling us that even if you become the president of America, it's not actually a straitjacket, meaning that there are some people behind the scene who are controlling
shots.
Meaning that even in America, which you think that is a democratic state, there are some people behind it. It's a club of a certain individual. So that's what we are simply saying, that it's not this democracy. To me, I can say, not only Africa, representative democracy is in trial. That's what I can say.
Anthony, representative democracy is on trial, according to Samson. What's your take about our African sense of democracy?
I have a different opinion from my fellow panelists. I think for me, African setup has always practiced democracy in this way. Our cultural makeup, when there was a leader, there was always the elder, the elders who are around the leader who give advisory. So it was never the decision of one individual. It was the decision of a lot of consultation, and after the consultation, a decision is made. What we are having in Africa is where you have few individuals who want to control the resources, and in the process of controlling the resources, they are willing and ready to kill to keep those positions. And not for any other thing, not for the good of the people, but for self-preservation. I must say this, in Africa, we had strategic countries that were supposed to be the pillars of good governance, of democracy. But others have come in. Others have made it worse. For example, anyone who wanted to come to Africa after the independence of South Africa, you always felt that you want to come to Africa, you come through South Africa. Or you go through Egypt. And those were places where was looked up to for guidance in Africa. But then there are two emerging countries, for example, Kenya and Nigeria. Because when you have Kenya as the entry point, you actually get into Africa at the middle of Africa. And you have the Nigeria on the other side, at the western side of the Africa, then you have Kenya and Nigeria, and you have South Africa down there, and you have the northern countries. No, right now it is a bit volatile, then you basically can get through Africa. And so, if you had democracy, a proper democracy, and with proper institutions of Africa, you have one in Kenya and another one in Nigeria, and let's say two in North Africa, you basically are able to say that, look, you have several examples in Africa. Unfortunately, South Africa, things are okay, though they have an issue with the president, but their system to control them. In Kenya, we would have done a lot for Africa. First, by talking to Tanzania and telling Tanzania, which Tanzania is a democracy, which actually a democracy that works. We're telling Tanzania that, look, Bwana, let's have a backup. If Kenya is a democratic spaces practice in Kenya, we tell Tanzania, look, we want to influence countries which are around us. And that means, if Uganda messes up the way it is messing up, we just close our borders and tell them. Ojai, I was listening. Okay. I was listening while you're talking.
But why are you worried?
Trying to disrupt me.
Okay, you just complete yourself.
Let me complete. When you have Kenya practice democracy, and we have a cooperation with Tanzania, we'll dictate to Uganda that, look, allow Besigye to air his view. Allow Besigye to have Israelis. Do proper election. If they refuse, we close our borders for 2 weeks.
Would that actually be interfering with the state of affairs of another country? Because I think they are sovereign states.
Yes.
And if Kenya and Tanzania and would want to gang up to dictate,
they are sovereign states, so long as they are actually working for their people.
I want to say this.
I want to say this. Who your leader
but
is. That's not democracy.
What I was saying.
Hold on, Anthony.
I think whatever we are discussing today,
yes,
you need to sharpen your thinking outside the box, yes, so that you know actually what you are talking about. The reason why I'm talking about representative democracy is on trial, simply because, for example, we want to be elected with 100 people, with the three of us,
yes,
and maybe we take the 60, all the two of us here take the 60, and you take 40. Meaning that he has the 30 and I have 30. You are the winner. Gaddafi asks a very simple question. Then who is ruling the 60 people? Who are the majority? majority are being actually ruled with the people, with a person or a government they never elected. But what do they do with a sham democracy? Wait for 5 years. So when you are saying that closing the border, you are not closing to the leadership on top. You are only starving the people who elected and the people who never elected that government. But that's why you are saying, that's why people go to school. We go to school so that we can work for serious issues and define all these things. What I'm simply saying, yes, people are saying, how do you call it? Not representative, but direct democracy. It's expensive. I want to say this. Still, we can do direct in a way that actually from the level of those words, people can sit down and decide what they want. So that when we are going for election for maybe 5 years, the people have decided and they have a common book holding actually their needs. Not an MP who wants you to go and talk about bridge in parliament, minus the people themselves. So we are not doing that. Even in Uganda, don't think that Museveni do not have people. Don't think that Besigye do not have people. But you are saying that Besigye, the people who elected you, Museveni must rule them, whether they like it or not. That's a democracy.
There's no problem with that. With Museveni even ruling, and Benibi didn't have the absolute majority. Because if the institutions that are in place are working, yes, if say the legislature was working, it would follow that the opposition, probably combined, would have the majority in the house. For instance, now like in the U.S. You find that Barack Obama, Democrats, they don't as much as they have the presidency, they don't control the Congress and the Senate.
Yes.
So the ones that you say, you cannot say that the ones who did not elect Obama, they are not represented. They are represented because they are institutions that are, because leadership is not necessarily coming from one quarter. You know, it is corrective when our institutions are working. There is no issue. The problem with our African setup is that our institutions, they don't work. What matters in our country now is the head, and they go and compromise our institutions.
I just want to correct you, Jaya, on something about Libya. You know, when you talk about Libya, what do you think about? What comes to your mind? What comes to your mind is Gaddafi.
Yes, and dictator.
I've not said
yes. Gaddafi and dictator.
Now
I know where you are heading to.
That is bad for a nation.
Yes.
Where you mention a nation and you think about an individual.
It is not yes. Massive.
In other words, what we are saying, Gaddafi failed to bring in strong institution that can outlive him. And that is a problem. And that system that Ajay is talking about.
Yes.
I've spent time reading about that system.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
How is it working? How is it working?
And that system could not work without Gaddafi.
No. Check Nick. Yes. So I want to say, just a minute.
Ahead of us going to the break, I want us to agree on one thing here. Much as we get very many concepts coming in from this discussion, it is imperative that we get to understand one thing, that democracy in Africa is actually has not taken off, because the success stories we have in Africa, like Ghana, Botswana, recently Nigeria, and Kenya, that actually was showing good signs, but now again there are issues here and there, is that our democracy can go and come back at any given time. So, talking about institutions.
Before we go for break.
Just a minute. Talking about institutions. Yes. I'm bringing this to Anthony. Talking about institutions that are weak.
Yes.
Do you think democracy can still thrive in any way?
That democracy, there are certain things, tenets that must be there for democracy to work. One, the people should be informed so that there are people who cannot be influenced by propaganda. And that is why you notice where democracy actually thrives, majority are actually informed and they know what is happening. So Nick, when you make a decision, they make a decision based on information they have.
Nick, I want to say this. Number one,
most Gaddafi,
I want to get this because...
Just a minute. I'm going to give you only... Just let me say half a minute.
Yes,
for you to
half a minute is like this.
Yeah.
Jaraganya has just said that actually, has read actually about that system of Gaddafi. When he was in the university, I know and for a fact that you're in university, but you never saw any book, one book, which talk about Jamhuria system. And if you go now in that University of Nairobi here, you'll not find one. What do you know about Gaddafi and Libya? is about the media, the Western media and concept, which you read. And you go this, go look for the third university. No, no, a minute. Go read the third universal theory. Go read the third universal theory and talk about parliament, election, and the political party. Then you relate it to democracy as a student who want to learn, not politicking. Then you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Forget about the Gaddafi as a person. Yes, you were seeing Gaddafi because the Western media wanted us to see Gaddafi instead of the positive things which actually Jamaica system did.
Okay, I can see you're a proponent of the Jamaica system so well. Mr. Kitonga, we are going for the break. Please, do you think our institutions, or is it a paradigm shift of concept that must come now for us to ensure that our democracy grows? Because institutions are somewhat weak, yes. I know people are not even sometimes understanding democracy in its own facets completely. But now, what are we supposed to do about the institutions?
Okay, it's very unfortunate because our democracy, we make one step forward and two steps backwards. And the main problem is with creating our institutions is that because the people that really come to power in most of our African countries, they don't come to power on ideology. They come to power through corruption, through tribalism, and they don't believe really in those institutions. So it will actually take the people, you know, to rise up against the bad governance, and we create good institutions. We have to put good governance in place for them at least who appreciate democracy. As Anani was saying, even if somebody like Gaddafi was doing good for the country, as long as you don't have the institutions, as long as people don't have the basic freedom.
Institution was there.
As
institutions
long as people
were there.
Don't have basic freedom, it doesn't matter.
Institutions
really what you
were
doing
there.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Institutions were there.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are taking a break. This is actually an analysis of what our democracy in Africa has come to be. Again, it's also an insight into what democracy actually does in the African states as it is. Or is it just a wild concept that somebody is trying to impose on us? When you come back, we'll be getting down to the details of this. Please don't go away. This is the Cardinal Talk. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, we are back now. The second segment of this program, we are still going to look into the process of democracy in Africa. How well it's grown and how well it's matured, or has it not? All these questions must be answered by these panelists who are here. And again, I want to introduce, if you're only joining us right now, Anthony Jaragenya. I've got with me here Samson Ojayo and Mr. Kitonga Wadanga. Today, we are looking at Africa and democracy. Have we grown? Are we stumbling? Or we are started. All the things must be said now. Now, gentlemen, we are only going to speak now about case points. Look at countries like Ghana. These are success stories about democracy in Africa. We can born and live there. Recently, Nigeria, which we're still giving time to see if it can actually get to the end of it. Kenya was actually one of the leading lights in democracy in Africa. But we could see things going back and forth, just like Gitonga said. Again, we have even other classes or classifications of leadership, like the Jamaria that Samson just speaks about. What are we supposed to embrace to ensure that our democracy grows and thrives? Because we must move on as a continent. This one is not negotiable. What must we do, Anthony?
And for me, where democracy works, and countries where you can clearly see that democracy is working, if you check from American democracy, which is almost more than 200 years, you look at Ghana, which you've just given, there's always one foundation, the baptism by blood. For example, the Ghana, when Jerry Rawlings becomes the president, he actually overturned two governments, and one of the president is actually killed. Reason being, they would certain things that they want. One of them was, we don't want corruption in this country. We want institutions to work, and that is why Jerry Rawlings says that we want to have a good constitution in this country, that even if the devil become our president, all Ghanaians are safe. The problem now we have in countries like Kenya, every institution fails because strategically people are placed to head those institutions to protect an individual or to protect certain group of individuals, not to serve the country. And you go to countries like Tanzania, which democracy right now is working. Why? Because the foundation was actually, the foundation was good by Mwalimu Nyerere. It was very clear to him and was willing and ready to put his life on the line or to kill to protect it.
Nick.
It is unfortunate that in our country, Kenya, what was the foundation? The foundation of independence, you get a guy who become the president and the first thing he start doing is by stealing from the people.
Grabbing
land.
I mean now this one, this one must be told in white, yes. Black and white.
I want to say
Samson. Now, in reference to other success stories in Africa, vis-a-vis Kenya, what are we seeing?
I want to say this. Number one, he's talking about Ghana. Before you see Lawrence, who do you see? You see Kwame Nkrumah.
Yes.
What did Kwame Nkrumah stand for? You talk about Nyerere. Nyerere stood also for something. You get the point? So, in other words, we are seeing the ideology which wanted actually the unification of Africa, first of all, Pan-Africanism.
Pan-Africanism, yeah.
As we are talking today, apart from Nyerere, a Kenyan person will brag and tell you that in fact Tanzania has failed. According to them, success is about skyscrapers and actually how much you can steal. But now we are saying it's also takes an individual. The way you are saying, that one does not mean that Kenya, African democracy, is actually gone completely. People are there actually to work for these institutions, because for example, coming back to Kenya, the institutions are there. I'm seeing actually William Mutunga, even though he's going to leave, trying to struggle with the court. The only problem that the old mindset is still there within that court corridor. Look at the point. And they are the people, even if you want to choose, still you can choose among them, because they are the people who are there. You see? And what we have done to make sure that even the young people who are young, but not young in idea, like now want to change the institution so that we have a better nation to live in. But that one does not mean that we don't see it. Even in the government, we have people who are very positive. Even in the opposition, we have also people who are very positive. But this idea of corruption is killing African, democracy. And that's why we are losing a lot in terms of corruption, in terms of now good governance. And also the electorate is like, they've not defined and actually known who are true people who we need to elect into the office. Also becomes a problem in Africa. And that's why when we are going for election, instead of people actually thinking about getting the leadership, you only see created tension. And in fact, within tension, criminal comes in and we elect criminals and people who do not believe in the leadership. That's actually what happened in Africa.
Mr. Gitonga, have your take?
Yeah, basically it boils down to the two issues of tribalism and corruption. When you look at say the success stories we're talking about, democracy in Africa, there's a very strong link between good governance, democracy, and economic affairs, status of a country. And the few countries that are doing well in Africa, definitely you see that they have good democratic principles. A country like Rwanda has been doing well so far, but they came from a very they had a very very rough start. They started with the civil war, and Kagame initially did well, but he got to a place where he thought that he's the only person who can deliver or sustain Rwanda. The problem is that when our leaders think that it is them as individuals who can deliver a country, that is where then they are not able to build institutions to govern, that institutions that will outlive them. And that's why now the democracy can't grow, because it depends on individuals. The same thing that we are seeing here also in this country, that it all depends now on the president or the deputy president. All the other institutions, they have practically failed. You talk about the police, you talk about the judiciary, you talk about, they are practically not working. And it is it is very worrying, because as much as Kibaki also had issues, but he did not have as many issues. He did not have this kind of governance. It was not so petty. And I was thinking the other day that had Uhuru become president in 2002 when Moi was trying to impose him on us, what problem would have gotten to if he's this petty?
He has had
experience as a minister, as a deputy prime minister. Would have been a lot of.
Should have been.
He's petty. He's somebody who is just having a good time.
I think what's going on over the world.
The big question here, just like Oye wants to say, I know very well that weak institutions will always lead to poor democracy.
Yes.
Every other thing will be affected by weak institutions. Yes. However, I want us to look at the African platform of democracy.
African platform.
And we can't also fail to compare situations like Kenya and the other places.
Yes.
Now, I'm coming to another point here that I want us to also debate. Now, looking at countries that actually did so well, like Rwanda, now are turning again against the very, very good tides and wanting to extend the constitution, or rather change the constitution for extension of presidency. We have Museveni has done this one. Just recently, I had Joseph Kabila also wants to do the same thing. And, you know, again, it's beginning the Zimbabwe's and all this. What does this one actually leave us with as a continent? Because they also affect the process of democracy in Africa.
Yeah, but Nick.
Anthony, please, go on.
Something as Mr. Gitonga says, that institutions are so important. Even if you had a rogue president, like I think, in my own opinion, that South Africans have a rogue president.
South Africa?
Yes.
They have a rogue president?
Yes.
In Jacob Zuma?
Yeah. Yes. And how? The other day, I think actually a month ago, because a family is they are friendly with that family, the family actually decided to land their helicopter, to fly the helicopter to a military barrack and land there just because the family was having a wedding of one of the sons, one of the daughters, the Gupta's families. But something very interesting that happened in South Africa, which all African countries need to admire. One, when Zuma decided to use public funds to build himself
a villa
and swimming pools, and he calls those are security gadgets. He was taken to court. What did the court say? The court said, no, you have to refund back that money. Meaning, the judiciary in those countries are still working. When this Gupta's family decided to misuse the military barracks, he was asked to that family was told, look, tell us why, under what circumstances this happened.
Nick,
this is only place that is only allowed to head of state. How did a family get access to the military barrack? And those things, when the South African asked for them, the institution which are there are working. So the parliament may not work in South Africa because it is ANC driven.
Nick.
But the judiciary would work.
Nick.
The civil society will work.
Nick.
The students will question those things. But in Kenya, the judiciary is compromised. The executive is compromised. The legislative function is compromised. We are actually in a very bad situation.
I hope you need to moderate this platform so that one person can reach it. You know, you are getting your time.
Be patient. You'll get your time. Yes. There's time for you. I hope Anthony, you are not saying that Kenya is becoming a failed state at all. We are having a country. Samson, what is this that you think is burning you?
Number one, I want you to moderate the way I've said this. It's not one person to preach.
What
I'm saying is like, number one thing we must know, that when you talk about South Africa, you know the history of South Africa, where it has come from. This nation, if it's something to go by, apart from independent constitution and all that, we have a new Kenya, which came into being in 2010. It's not even 10 years. About 2010 is how many years? It's less than that. So what I'm saying, actually, the institutions are already there. What is going to happen? those institutions are going to clean themselves one by one. People will go out, new blood. No, no, it's, you must start from somewhere. We are talking about Soma, and we know the contradiction which was there when Ivan Mandela came into the office. We know what happened. But if you think that democracy works like this, you are lying.
It's not instantaneous.
No, it can't work. And these people, and that's why sometimes I fail to understand that you sit down and you want to talk about the best democracy and you want to compare yourself with America. Unless you are sick. You're talking about how many years? They started somewhere. And if you want to read the, know the history of America, you'll find so many contradictions within that way. But now as a nation, it has become their way of life. Within this institution, we have people who are, can work for this nation. Within this institution, we have people who have the old mindset. So what we are simply saying, judiciary as a body or as an institution is there. What we need to do, that how can we get the right people and the right, but you cannot get them as we are talking, because when you are doing interview, the same people will come with the papers, package themselves at the center of this nation. So even if you say that now you want to say that this government is the one who is doing and all that, because Kenyans are fond of now bringing blame games all the time, even people, the things they are seeing.
Now you are telling us you want
to wait.
You're telling us we want to wait for 200 years for
nothing like 200 years. The world is not ending up with you.
Samson, must we also wait for another 200 years before we?
The world is not ending up with him.
Mr. Kitonga, have your say, please.
We have a chance. We learn from what other countries went through. Yes. We don't have to make the same mistakes.
Yes.
You know, we learn from the mistakes of others.
Yes.
But in Kenya and in most of African countries, we want to learn from our mistakes. And that is why we find ourselves in conflict.
And sometimes we're trying to repeat the mistake other countries have done.
We, like which one?
This week, a gorilla, there's a gorilla unit in Uganda.
Okay,
they have said they are taking up arms.
Yes.
They are taking up arms.
Yes.
But why? It's because we don't even learn from, Uganda has not learned from the mistakes they did. You know, they want to do it all over again. Despite them having made some progress, then they are going now a couple of steps backwards. And we are doing the same thing here in this country. We can't learn from the mistakes that we did previously. That us having gone into elections with an IBC that was not credible. It led to violence in this country. We are about to go to elections again with an IEBC that is not credible.
Can I ask a personal question?
No, just a bit.
Can I ask a question?
Complete before you
that, even people in Jubilee, like in Kericho, they are complaining about IEBC.
Yeah.
And they're in government.
Yeah.
Those people are not in government because they are competing against the government.
Okay.
Those people are in court.
Gentlemen, now I must close this now. Let's close this now. Maybe I want to give everybody a second just to give a parting shot.
Yes.
Anthony, very fast, because we are closing.
Thank you. Thank you, Nick.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you for Lolo for giving us a chance to discuss these issues. The issues we're discussing here not only affect Africa, but they particularly affect Kenya. In Kenya, we have leadership that do not respect the institution. They do not respect the constitution, and they do things as if we are in the jungle. It is unfortunate that we are in this situation. The only way to solve it is for those of us who want to change it, to take their vote, to go and register as voters, and to prepare themselves to vote the right leadership come 2017.
Thank you.
I think number one, I've said that the institutions are actually okay. We have some people who actually are not good within those institutions. But I think with the Jubilee administration, we are going forward. We are not here actually to join the people who are only seeing negative, while positives are also there. They've never talked about positive. So if they are still talking about positive, and my learned friend have said that you take your vote, so that you vote Jubilee for the second time, we want to see what Uhuru is going to do in the next, actually, some 6 years to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Kitonga. I have your last shot.
Thank you. When we look at across Africa, we see that the few democracies that exist were started, or the pillar was probably one revolutionary individual. We look at Tanzania, we had Nyerere. We look at Uganda, no, not Uganda, we had South Africa, we had Nelson Mandela. In Ghana, they had Lawrence and Kwame Nkrumah. In Kenya, unfortunately, where the people who have been in power have been paying lip service in for democracy. But we have a chance. We have one person who really believes and has lived democracy in this country and has really fought that we have an opportunity in this country to turn our country around by electing one Raila Amolo Odinga into office. Okay. And I believe if we get Raila Amolo Odinga into office next 2017, then Kenya now will be on the path to democratization.
I wish you well.
Well, yes. It's been a fantastic, a very good and sober debate about democracy in Africa. We've seen case studies, comparative analysis, and this is what we want you to always get out of this program. It is my interest to also tell you that this program has the potential of transforming our thinking, going into the future, and we hope that you will always find time to be with us on this program every Sunday at this particular time. Without taking much time, guys, thank you very much. You've been so wonderful. You people are just awesome. I can't wait to have you in the next show. Thank you, viewers. Wherever you are, please keep it LTN because we must move our country and Africa ahead.